just alone. My hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, blood spoke on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe. This gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. Till on that cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid, here in the death of Christ I live. Body lay, light of the world by darkness slain, then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, since curse has lost its grip on me, for I am his and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. In life, no fear in death. This is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand. Till he returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ I'll stand.
Good morning and welcome to the Heartland United Methodist Church. My name is Pastor Paul Grunberg, and I want to invite you to this morning to join us as we celebrate God, as we celebrate life, as we look to love and to care for one another, as we at Heartland, we're sharing the journey to know, love, and serve God. Good morning and welcome. I want to encourage you to grab your morning juice or coffee. I hope you've had a chance to turn in your Bible to chapter 10 of John, the Gospel of John. And also, importantly, most importantly, have something to write with and something to take notes on. you always want to remember when God has spoken to you, and you want to write that down so that you have a record of that. It helps you to retain what it is that God is speaking to you about. Hey, let me know that you're watching. Give a thumbs up or use that emoji, the heart. When God is speaking to you, make a comment or write a comment. We'll come to a time of prayer later on in the service. And again, in the comments section, just use first names only. But if you have a prayer request that you would like others to pray, to join with you in praying for or interceding for someone else, just write their name and just a couple of words to help us know. Maybe it's health. Maybe it's another situation that you would like lifted up. Use the comment section for that. As we proceed on, I do have an announcement here. We are going to have a food drive for two Sundays in June, or 2 days in June, I'm sorry. And all you need to do is buy the groceries, put it in the trunk. When you pull up to the church, pop the trunk, someone will grab the bags from you and then close your trunk. We're doing this to help those who are needy. We want to help supply food, non-perishable items to the Gleaners Food Bank, that those who are really suffering and in need in our area can get the help that they need. Pass the word to those that you know and love, your friends, your family. They too can join in on that particular day. It will be announced in the newsletter when those days are. Also, the bishop has sent out a letter based on what's been said. He's giving the church responsibility to begin to open up. We're in an area where there's a lot of pandemic, and so we will probably be slower to opening up than, say, some of the churches up north, which the governor has opened up a little bit more. And so keep praying for the flattening of that curve, for the healing of our nation in regard to this pandemic. I do have a question for you. It's this: what is it that you look forward to? What is it that you live for? Maybe it's sports, maybe it's ice cream. Maybe it's food. Maybe it includes spending time with family, doing those other types of things. What is it that you really look forward to, you want to live life for in this life? Answer that question. Write it down on your piece of paper. Let's pray. Almighty God, we are grateful for an opportunity to join you virtually, to worship you as a community of faith. And for all those who are familiar with us and those who are unfamiliar, Lord, I pray that you would speak to our hearts this day. Lord, that we would glorify you and find you. In Jesus' name, and all God's people said, say it with me, amen, amen. Hey, let's join together now in our call to worship. Actually, yeah, our call to worship this morning. It'll be on the screen. Say it out loud. And say it with joy. O creating God, mighty shepherd and constant companion, we your people come to worship you with all of heaven. Lead us to know you and praise your wonderful name. Say it out loud. Amen. Amen. We're now going to join together in a time of praise. We're going to sing that very familiar hymn made familiar by Cat Stevens, Morning Has Broken.
Morning has broken like the first morning. Blackbird has spoken like the first bird. Praise for the singing, praise for the morning. praise for them springing fresh from the Word. Sweet the rain's new fall, sunlit from heaven, like the first dewfall on the first grass. Praise for the sweetness of the wet garden, sprung in completeness where his feet pass. Mine is the sunlight, mine is the morning, born of the one light Eden saw play. Praise with elation, praise every morning, God's recreation of the new day. Amen. Amen. Let us
the words of a modern affirmation. Say that out loud with me. Say it out loud with me. We believe in God the Father, infinite in wisdom, power, and love, whose mercy is over all his works, and whose will is ever directed to his children's good. We believe in Jesus Christ, Son of God and Son of Man, the gift of the Father's unfailing grace, the ground of our hope and the promise of our deliverance from sin and death. We believe in the Holy Spirit as the divine presence in our lives, whereby we are kept in perpetual remembrance of the truths of Christ and find strength and help in time of need. We believe that this faith should manifest itself in the service of love as set forth in the example of our blessed Lord, to the end that the kingdom of God may come upon the earth. Amen. Let us join together in a time of worship, a chorus of worship, a hymn of worship, Fairest Lord Jesus.
Fairest Lord Jesus, ruler of all nature, O thou of God and man, the Son, thee will I cherish, thee will I honor, thou my soul's glory, joy, and crown. Fair are the meadows, fairer still the woodlands, robed in the blooming garb of spring. Jesus is fairer, Jesus is purer, who makes the woeful heart to sing. Fair is the sunshine, fairer still the moonlight, and all the twinkling starry hosts. Jesus shines brighter, Jesus Jesus shines purer than all the angels heaven can boast. Just worship this with this last verse. Beautiful Savior, Lord of all nations, Son of God and Son of Man, glory and honor, praise, adoration, now and forevermore be thine. Glory and honor. Glory and honor, praise, adoration, now and forevermore be thine. Amen. Amen. We've been going through the parables across the synoptics, biographies of Jesus written by Matthew, Mark, and Luke. Synoptic, meaning taking a common view or the same view, in this case of Jesus. And in the biographies or the gospels of Jesus, the writers share 46 parables that Jesus told to the people that were gathered around him. Now, the synoptic gospels share 7 of the parables. They each tell 7 specific parables, and we've gone through those. Parable of cloth and parable of wine, 4 soils, how heaven is like a mustard seed, a parable about wicked tenants, and a parable about the future that includes a fig tree. As an added bonus, I'm including a parable from the Gospel of John, not one of the synoptics, but John only really tells one parable of Jesus, and I believe this is a really important parable. Now, let me set the stage why Jesus shares this parable. You see, Jesus has been on the stage or the scene for nearly 3 years, and he's creating not only a stir, but it's a division on who people believe he is. John shows how the leadership of the Jews, that is the priests and the Pharisees, how they were having a difficult time determining who this young rabbi was. He was physically healing people. He was speaking with power. And the Pharisees and leaders are really stirred about him. And then in the chapter prior to coming to John chapter 10, our parable, we note that it's the Sabbath. It's a Sunday. Well, their Sabbath was a Saturday. And according to the law of Moses, it's a day of rest. And with all this anxiety over who Jesus is approached by a blind man, again, on the Sabbath, and he heals him. And in the eyes of the Jewish leader, they don't care if it's raining down manna from heaven. What Jesus just did, healing or working on the Sabbath, was a no-no. Sometimes, let's face it, sometimes you just cannot please people, even if the truth is staring them right in the face. So in their eyes, he could not be the Messiah, but he must be, and this is what they said, demon-possessed. All that he was doing was out of the power of the demonic, the evil one, which in reality is an affront to the Holy Spirit who resides in Jesus and is the source of power who is doing the healing in and through Jesus. That is even a bigger no-no. And it is covered later in the Gospels. But that's not what we're covering today. I'm just setting the stage. These Pharisees are really angry. They're really confused. Who is this young rabbi?
He must be, if not the Son of God, he must be demon-possessed. Now, if you've got your Bible open, we're going to start reading in the first chapter of John, first verse of John chapter 9, and I'll read it with you. Very truly, I tell you, Pharisees, anyone who does not enter the sheep pen by the gate, but climbs in by some other way, is a thief and a robber. The one who enters by the gate is the shepherd of the sheep. The gatekeeper opens the gate for him, and the sheep listen to his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he has brought out all of his own, he goes on ahead of them, and his sheep follow him because they know his voice. They will never follow a stranger. In fact, they will run away from him because they do not recognize a stranger's voice. Jesus used this figure of speech, but the Pharisees did not understand what he was telling them. Let us pray. Almighty God, in this moment of worship, in this act of proclaiming your word, we ask that you would pour out your Holy Spirit on us. Lord, that we might continue to listen to you, that we might hear clearly your still small voice. And Lord, I pray that the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart would be pleasing to you, my rock and my Savior. Amen. Amen. Hey, I was out walking our dog Moses the other day, and Moses is a large dog, and he is a golden retriever. And we were out walking, and as we're walking down the road, and our road is about 2 miles around, or 1 mile around, we're coming up to a house, and this dog bounds off its porch. Now, Moses is on my left side, and I'm towards the middle of the road, and all of a sudden, Moses is pressing against my leg as we're walking. It's just the cutest thing. But he sees what's happening, and this dog is coming at us, and he's barking with all that he's got, or she, as I found out later, is barking with all that she has, and she's just got this puffed up chest, and she is just charging and looking menacing. And so I said to Moses, "Moses, come over here," and I led Moses to the other side of my body, and I am now in between the dog charging us and Moses. And then in a commanding voice, I look at the dog that's charging us, and I say, "Go home. Stop. Go home." And the dog slows down. Now, as we continue passing the house, I say to Moses, "Come on, Moses, let's keep going." And Moses follows along, and then I eventually have Moses come over to the other side as we're walking. The dog, I understand and I recognize, has lived there. And this is that dog's home, or in the dog's mind, its possession. And in the same way the chief priests and the Pharisees have grown accustomed to their territory, they've grown accustomed to their position of power and prestige. And Jesus, this young rabbi, is upsetting the balance. He is creating turmoil in not only their minds, but in the minds of the people. Some are following him. And bear in mind, they think, the Pharisees, they think that Jesus' ability to bring healing, to speak with power, is because he is demon-possessed. Again, covered in a different part of the Gospels, you never want to say that to a Christian, that they're demon-possessed, in regard to what the Holy Spirit is doing in their life. Now, in sharing this parable, John, in verse 6, says these words. Read them out loud with me. Jesus used this figure of speech, but the Pharisees did not understand what he was telling them. Now, maybe Jesus was speaking too fast, or maybe it was just simply a riddle to the Pharisees and the chief priests, and they just simply didn't understand what Jesus was getting at. Although I would think that with their learning and understanding of the Old Testament, that they would have been able to understand what Jesus was saying about the sheep and the gate pen, the robber and the thieves. So Jesus presses on with this parable and begins to explain what he's talking about. He says, "I am the gate for the sheep." Important to know. Jesus is the gate for the sheep. Read the rest with me. "All who have come before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep have not listened to them. I am the gate. Whoever enters through me will be saved." The sheep are the Jews who have been listening to Jesus' voice. And Jesus is the gate. Jesus is the gate. Whoever enters through me, say it out loud, will be what? Will be saved. Saved. The Jewish concept for the Messiah was that this mighty warrior would come and set them free from Roman rule, and they would again possess the land, the promised land, and all would be made right. But Jesus is not speaking about salvation from the Romans or having their land back. He's talking about salvation for all eternity, being in relationship with God. These false shepherds are the thieves and the robbers, and these are seducers and deceivers. They want to get into the sheep's pen to take out sheep. They want to create and stir the church up. A robber is a man who will use violence and cruelty to get their way. When I think of these types of people, they're led by the evil one, the true evil one, who would destroy others, who would seek to destroy all of the sheep that are following Jesus' voice, the shepherd's voice, as well as those who are not in the pen yet. And that just the heckles on the hair on the back of my neck. I just don't like that at all. If there's a sense of them having an internal radio that's tuned into the voice of someone, these thieves and robbers, it's tuned into the voice of the evil one. That would be like on some of those old Western movies. The ranch hands from one ranch are stealing and taking cattle or sheep from another ranch. And they do this not because of their own volition. They do this because someone is telling them to. And that's generally the opposing ranch owner, which leads me to one of two statements that I want us to dwell on today. There's just so much here. And it's this: the thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. "I have come that they may have life and have it to" what? Have it to the full. This is one of those scriptures to hide deep in your heart. This is one of those scriptures to memorize and to keep with you at all times. You see, Jesus comes to impart what? To impart life. To have life to the full, or in another translation, to have life abundantly. An abundant life. A life that's found in Christ. Not perishing, not corruptible. One that finds satisfaction, one that finds security, one that finds enjoyment in a relationship with each other and with God. And this life is only found in Jesus Christ. He is the gate, as well as the good shepherd. And he is the one who leads us into the shadow of the Almighty God. I delight in this kind of life. Even when it's hard, even when things seem to be going south, I have peace knowing that I'm in a right relationship with Jesus. In fact, my peace tends to go away when I'm not in that right relationship with Jesus, when I'm letting Jesus kind of drift away from me, or when I actually am drifting away from Christ, that's when I feel less peace. But when I'm with Christ, when I'm in the Word, when I'm spending time with God, my peace is up. My satisfaction with life is good. Don't you want that? Don't you want that kind of satisfaction, enjoyment out of life because you're in relationship with Jesus, with God? Not just now, but for all eternity. So many people are walking around the world with this idea that there is nothing after their last breath here. And that's not what this parable is saying. This parable is saying that Jesus is the gatekeeper. Jesus is the shepherd who draws us into that relationship with God to have that full and abundant life. It's not about wealth. It's not about prestige, fame, or power. It's knowing that you are loved and empowered by God. Empowered by God to live a life of joy, of peace, of kindness, of love. And to know that you are resting in the arms of the Almighty. That is true peace. That is true enjoyment. But to have this, you must trust God to bring you into the sheep pen. And God wants you to be there. Not in the world. Not to be controlled by robbers or thieves or deceivers. But to be loved by a loving God. Now the Pharisees, the readers or the leaders, as we read forward, they seem to be more like hired hands. Jesus said, I am the good shepherd, and the good shepherd lays down his life for his sheep. And yet we do not see these Pharisees and these chief priests laying down their lives for their people. They're accumulating wealth. They're accumulating power and prestige. In fact, Jesus says this, the hired hand is not the shepherd and does not own the sheep. So when he sees the wolf coming, he abandons the sheep and runs away. The hired hands are not sold out for the sheep. In fact, the hired hands don't own the sheep. God owns the sheep. We are owned by God. We are created by God to be in a relationship with God. But we have to choose that. I hope you have chosen that. I hope each morning you wake up and you say, Lord, this day I choose you to be my God and my Savior. We know of only two of the leaders in the priests and the Pharisees that would eventually openly admit that they were disciples of Jesus. Only two that we know of for sure. But I'm assuming that there were some others because of what they did, because of who Jesus was. The Holy Spirit, remember, the Holy Spirit is seeking you out. Even when you're far away, the Good Shepherd is calling you by name. I hope you remember that earlier on. The Shepherd knows you by name. He knows every hair on your head. Wouldn't it be nice to be known that way? You can have it in Jesus. And with the second most important part I want to share with you today, I have to go back to verse 4 and then add in some other verses. Read it with me. When he has brought out all he owns, all his own, he goes on ahead of them, and his sheep follow him because they know his voice. But the sheep have not listened to the false shepherd. I have other sheep. They too will listen to my voice. I think a key here, if you walk away with anything, is that you would need to turn on that internal radio and begin to tune in your frequency to hear the shepherd's voice. He says, his sheep follow him because they know his voice. When is it that you hear the voice of God? When is it in your day that you take time to hear the voice of God? Do you set time aside in the morning or in the evening to be in God's Word, to take in the voice of God, to listen for the still small voice of God? Maybe you have taken in some of God's Word. The thief only comes to kill, steal, and destroy, but I have come that they might have life and have it to the full, or have an abundant life. That's one of those scriptures that God uses for me to remind me when I may be heading off the path, the beaten path that God wants me to follow. And he says, I have come that you might have life. And I have to think about, what is that life that I really, really want? Is it power? Is it prestige? Fame? Wealth? No, those are the things that the thief uses to draw me away from God. When do you spend time listening for the voice of God? And if you're not hearing the voice of God well these days, what is it that you think you need to do in order to begin hearing it again? How do you need to tune in to that voice of God? What is it that you think you need to do to hear God's voice? Well, we've already said a part of it is being in the Word. A part of it is having the Word in your heart so that God might bring it up when we need it throughout the course of the day. And when you're in the Word in the morning, this is something I would encourage you to do. What is the one thought that you want to carry that you feel Jesus has spoken to you, the Word has spoken to you, the Holy Spirit has impressed upon your heart for that day? What is that one thought that you need to carry throughout your day? Because I know that God will use that word in your day somehow. And all of a sudden, you're not just hearing the voice of God in the morning or in the evening. And if you do it in the evening, revisit it really quickly in the morning so you have that word for the day. But I know that God will use that word in your life. And all of a sudden, you'll be hearing more of God. You'll be hearing that still small voice of the Holy Spirit, the shepherd speaking into your life. Don't you want to hear those warm tones from God? The strength of encouragement, sometimes the sharp tone of warning. Stay away from that. Maybe the calm tone of reassurance, the welcoming tone of being forgiven for something that you know you did wrong and you have confessed to Jesus. I want to live my life with love, with joy, with peace. I know you want that too. And there are people in your lives, maybe some are listening this morning, who don't experience that often enough. Let me encourage you to get into the Word of God. If it's a first time for you, I would say open it up to the New Testament, the Gospels of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Read Mark first. Read John next. And hear the Good Shepherd's voice. Jesus still wants to speak into your life today. Jesus is still calling more sheep to the sheep pen. And what's interesting with that analogy is that when we hear the voice of the Good Shepherd, there are other sheep around us who will naturally want to stay near us. And as we move towards the Shepherd, they too will move toward the Great Shepherd. This is just such a wonderful, wonderful parable. To be loved by God, to be called by God, to be used by God. Amen. When we think of the Good Shepherd, Jesus, when he shares this parable with the Pharisees, is recalling probably one of the best known psalms that's ever been written by a boy who would be used by God to slay a giant, a boy who would grow up to be a king. You know that psalm I'm thinking of? It's Psalm 23. And what I want you to do now is just put your pen down, paper, pencil. Just relax, maybe even close your eyes as I finish off with Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen. Say it out loud. Amen. Lord, we're grateful for this opportunity to listen and hear. Father, we pray in Jesus' name that you would draw us to yourself in this moment. Lord, that you would draw us closer to the great shepherd's voice. Lord, we ask that as we live our lives, that we would live them in glory to you, that we would seek you, and Lord, that we would be found by you, and we would find you. And Almighty God, we ask that you would help us to live into that abundant life, that you would provide our needs, Lord, that you would be glorified in how we live our lives. In Jesus' name, and all God's people said, amen. We're going to sing a song now, a very familiar song. It's Amazing Grace. Sing it with us. As long as I can be.
The earth shall soon dissolve like snow, the sun forbear to shine, but God who called me here below will be forever mine, will be forever mine. Amen. Amen. Give back to God. An opportunity to continue to say to God, thank you for what you've given to me. Here's a portion that I want to give back to you. And so as we commit ourselves and those things that we hold dear to us to the Lord, you have an opportunity that you can give back to the Lord by going to our website at heartlandumc.org and press the give button if you've not given before. If you have been and continue to, or if you have been giving and you continue to give throughout this pandemic, I want to just say a special word of thanks as we continue to do life and ministry together. I'm really excited about this collecting food for gleaners, and so make sure you're looking for that, and we'll put it out on our website. As a response, we want to praise God, acknowledging from whom all our blessings flow. So let's do that together.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Let's enter into a time of prayer. Again, I want to remind you that in the comments section below, if you would like to lift up somebody, a prayer request or a need, just type the first name of the person and what that need might be. Just briefly, we'll get that out to our prayer chain. And certainly you can pray for them as those prayers requests come up. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Almighty God, we are grateful for the life you have given to us, for the abundant life that is just awaiting for us as we follow the voice of the shepherd. And Lord, we ask in Jesus' name that as we follow that voice, Lord, that you would speak to our hearts, that you would cause us to hear again your still small voice, or that small voice of the Holy Spirit. And Lord, I pray that as we continue to lift up those heroes of ours, those who are on the front line of the pandemic, we pray that you would continue to strengthen them and protect them. Lord, that you would give them wisdom as they approach each new case with love and with caring. Father, we thank you for first responders and others on the front line who go into situations and ask again that you would protect them, Lord. And Father, that these heroes, these families who have been apart from their children for such a long time, Lord, that soon we can be back together and get those hugs, not just see each other through a window or on Facebook or some electronic device. Lord, we continue to ask for those who are with COVID-19. Lord, we continue to ask for healing for them and for those who maybe it's a flu or a bug or maybe people who are hurt. Lord, we pray for healing for those people and ask that your hand would be upon them. Lord, we pray for those who have been isolated, who have been feeling very alone during this time. We ask in Jesus' name that you would bring these people's names to minds of by their friends, and that they would connect with them, that they would make that effort to connect. And Lord, that you would help them to see hope. Lord, that you would help them to see the light at the end of the tunnel. Lord, we pray for wisdom as we seek to begin to open up businesses, as we begin to open up churches, houses of worship. Lord, we pray for your wisdom to the leaderships. Lord, that you would help us to protect the most vulnerable. And Lord, for the seed that is in each one of us. Lord, for that place in our lives where your Holy Spirit resides. Lord, we pray that you would help us to understand how great a value that relationship with you is, that you walk with us and that you talk with us and that you call us your own. Lord, we thank you. We thank you for sending Jesus, who taught us about love, about grace, who taught us about following you and listening to your still small voice, your shepherd's voice. And Lord, we thank you for the prayer that he taught us, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen." Amen. I want to remind you that as we continue to go throughout this week, that we should be listening for the still small voice, the voice of the shepherd, and that we should be looking to live into the abundant life that God has created for us. Now may the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Take a moment to share this video with your friends on Facebook. Let them know of the peace, the joy, and the love of God. Go in peace. Amen. Praising God. And we'll see you shortly.